if anybody's detecting any audio problems or if there seem to be any technical issues. But if not, first of all, welcome to the Yale Physics Club. It's a pleasure to see you all on Zoom anyway, and someday soon in person for sure. Let me start by introducing myself. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Jack Harris. I'm a professor in the physics department, and I'll be the host for today's Physics Club talk. I've chatted with our speaker, and he has said that in the course of his talk, if you have questions, let's just pretend we're in person and you can interrupt as you normally would. And it'll be my job as moderator to try and shepherd us to a timely conclusion. But at least if you have questions, just feel free to go ahead and ask them. It's a giant pleasure to be able to welcome Charles Brown back to the physics department for this visit. Charles received his bachelor's degree with honors from the University of Minnesota and came to Yale to do his PhD in 2013. I was fortunate to become his PhD advisor, and Charles worked in my group on an unusual and very open-ended research project whose goal was to magnetically levitate large drops of superfluid helium in vacuum and study their fluid mechanics, their optical cavity properties, their thermodynamics. By 2019, Charles had succeeded at that and defended his PhD thesis. At that point, he went to the University of California at Berkeley, where he joined Dan Stamper-Kern's group. There, he has been studying ultracold atoms in optical lattices with a focus on the topological properties and many body effects in exotic band structures. And that's the work that he's going to be presenting to us today. So welcome, Charles. I will mute myself, and please take it away.
Awesome. Thank you, Jack, for the introduction. And thank you all for inviting me to come and speak in the Physics Club today. Certainly very excited to be here and tell you about the work I've been doing. Let me share my screen. Here's PowerPoint. I must say it's very fun to be visiting under different circumstances. Very nice. There we go. Okay. Hide this. Okay, yes, thank you again for the invitation. Today I'm going to tell you about the recent work we've done in the optical lattice subgroup in the Stamper-Kern lab at Berkeley, where I've been looking at a probe of band structure singularities using a lattice-trapped quantum gas. Okay, so before I move on, I wanted to acknowledge the sources of funding. Of course, you know, this funding is important for us to be able to actually do the work that we do. But also importantly, I wanted to acknowledge my experimental and theoretical colleagues, in particular, these awesome grad students that I work with, Xiaowen Chong and Malte Schwartz, and a grad student who recently converted to postdoc before taking a very nice industry job. And of course, my PI, my postdoc advisor, Dan Stamper-Kern. But also mention our theory collaborators, a grad student, a postdoc who's soon taking a faculty job, and Joel Moore. So together we've done this work together and produced something that I think is very interesting and very important actually. And so I mentioned that I'm going to tell you about a probe of band structure singularities with this lattice trapped quantum gas. And as it turns out, I like to think of this as a quantum simulator. And so I'm going to tell you about quantum simulation, what it is, and what I think we can do with it. I would then tell you about our ingredients that make up our quantum simulator and some recent experiments where we've used this quantum simulator to study some topological properties of what looks like graphene. There we go. Okay, so let me start by saying what quantum simulation is. One way to think of it is the mimicking of quantum systems for the purpose of understanding their states, phases, and dynamics. So I think in general, it's fair to use an expression like this of an Hamiltonian that tells you something about the energy of a system, where that Hamiltonian has three parts. It has a kinetic energy, it has a potential energy, and it has some sort of interaction. Now, sometimes this Hamiltonian can take a very simple form. Sometimes it can take a very complicated form, where you would be interested in trying to use a simpler quantum system that can realize a Hamiltonian of choice that sort of, you know, retains the salient interesting properties of the system that you want to study described by this Hamiltonian. Now, if you're going to do quantum simulation to study some, you know, maybe some toy model Hamiltonian or something more complicated where simulation is particularly useful, you might do so using digital simulation or analog simulation. At least I like to divide them in this way. So I would say that digital simulation requires a quantum computer device, something like what Google or IBM has, or Honeywell or IonQ, you know, a trapped ion system or a superconducting circuit system like the nice systems that are down the hill in the Devrient-Shokov groups. In this sort of simulation, you might initialize a state, you perform some quantum algorithm on that state, which really just means performing a series of transformations on the qubits, and then you perform some measurement to get your result. And that's in contrast to analog simulation. We're using this these different sort of physical systems to, for example, measure what is the ground state of a Hamiltonian, for example. And so an analog simulation system might look like cold atoms and lattices, which is what I'm going to talk to you about today, but it could also look like a chain of trapped ions, or it could look like arrays of optical tweezers filled with Rydberg atoms, which you can use to define qubits, or it could look like an all photonic system. Now, I also like to think about quantum simulators as being able to address two problem types. At least these two problem types are quite distinct in my mind. You can categorize them as time-dependent problems or ground state problems. So let's start with the time-dependent problem. Maybe you're interested in looking at problems related to equilibration and thermalization, where, for example, in this experiment, what's plotted is the density versus time, where the experimenters sort of shuffle all their atoms to one side of a lattice and watch how they diffuse and how the site density fluctuates with time. Or maybe you're interested in dynamical phase transitions, which could be sort of fast quenches through a transition or slow evolution through a transition, where in this experiment, experimenters use a superfluid and evolve the superfluid through a phase transition and see how excitations in the form of quantized vortices appear as they sweep across this phase transition. Or you maybe want to look at kick systems, Fouquet systems, where you introduce a time-dependent energy term in the Hamiltonian that describes your system. And there's a wide, you know, array of physics that you can address with this sort of system. Now, I also want to talk about ground states. Quantum simulation, I think, is particularly interesting for looking at ground states of Hamiltonians. Maybe you want to look at quantum magnetism. For example, here, this is an image of an antiferromagnet from a quantum gas microscope where you can really resolve site by site, where you have site by site resolution of atoms in your lattice. And so what you're seeing in this picture here, the blue and the white are the alternating spin up and spin down of this magnet. Or maybe you want to look at quantum spin liquids, another very interesting system to look at, state to look at. Where you can sort of think of it as a general state that is a superposition of ordered spin states, but that in its superposition sort of loses this long range order even down to zero Kelvin. So lastly, but not least, maybe you even want to look at aspects of superconductivity, where, you know, for example, the Hewlett group is starting to look at how superconductivity might appear in these nice one-dimensional systems. Okay. Now, I just told you about a lot of condensed matter things, condensed matter physics that you might want to look at using a quantum simulator, but I also want to make the point that quantum simulation is not just for condensed matter. Quantum simulation experiments may provide insight on problems in particle physics. So here, what I'm showing you is an image of what it might look like to realize synthetic gauge fields using atoms in a lattice. So here, I have a lattice with atoms at them. That's what you're saying in the square lattice arrangement. These circles are your atoms. You can see in these square plaquettes, you have these little red vectors coming out. That's the effective magnetic field that you can create by producing some sort of phase change that atoms experience as they move around this lattice. So why would you want to make what looks like a synthetic magnetic field? Well, that's because high energy physics tells us that gauge fields are ubiquitous in nature. For example, the gauge field associated with electromagnetism is the photon. With the strong force, it is the gluons. With the weak force, it's the W and Z particles. And so, you know, these sort of cold atom quantum simulators are interesting systems to imagine trying to produce artificial gauge fields, which you might achieve by doing a couple different techniques where you can shake your lattice in a particular way, or you can utilize the state manifold, say associated with the hyperfine structure, to do laser-assisted tunneling that helps you realize a synthetic gauge field. Now, before I move on, I wanted to sort of emphasize that if you can make this process time-dependent, then you have dynamical gauge fields, and that's particularly exciting because then you're really moving into a regime where maybe one day you could test some interesting properties of field theories that become relevant for high energy systems. Okay, now while I think that's incredibly interesting, I have in recent years been focused on solid state systems. And so why do I want to study solid state systems? Well, because there are many exciting questions on interesting physics, such as exotic superconductivity and magnetism, quantum Hall effects, or other topological matter. So in trying to sell you on this point, I want to tell you that, you know, an ultra cold atom quantum simulator offers several advantages. That is, controllable defects. These are advantages relative to solid state systems. That is, controllable defects, long-lived quantum coherence, the ability to prepare many identical copies, and the ability to study out of equilibrium physics, which we do a particularly good job of in my lab. Okay, and so the main point I want you to take away from here is that I believe we can provide great insight into the behavior of solid materials that have crystalline lattice structure. Okay. This image that I'm showing you here is a diffraction image from our optical honeycomb lattice in the lab. So in a way that's sort of similar to how, you know, a crystallographer might diffract, say, X-rays from a solid crystal, we can diffract atoms, usually Bose-Einstein condensates in my lab, from an optical lattice and learn about the physics of the atoms in the lattice. Okay, so as I move forward, I want to tell you about the different parts of our quantum simulator, how we realize one, before I actually show you what it looks like and then start to talk about the physics that I've been exploring with it recently. And in order to do so, first I need to tell you about a crystalline lattice. A definition of a crystalline lattice that I like is it's a periodic set of points that has some set of symmetries. For instance, the square lattice, it has translation symmetry. What I mean by that, well, you can define a unit cell, say a box around this point, and I can translate it up or down or to the right or to the left, and I can completely span this lattice. You'll also notice that this lattice has a rotational symmetry. I can rotate this lattice by 90 degrees and it produces the same lattice. There's another lattice, the triangular lattice, where again, it has translation symmetry and it has its own set of rotational symmetries. Another lattice is the Kagome lattice that's near and dear to our hearts. And it again has a translation symmetry, but it also has a set of rotational symmetries. This is not all the lattices, but just a nice selection that I think is representative. Now, even though these lattices look different, what's common to all of them is that they have an associated band structure, which is the allowable energy levels of particles that are confined in that lattice. So what I'm showing you here is just a one-dimensional band structure the band structure associated with a one-dimensional lattice. And I'm plotting it for you in two cases. One is when the confinement, where I'm parameterizing it by this quantity V lat, the confinement to the lattice sites is zero. So there's essentially no lattice for the particles. Whereas in this case, it's non-zero. In the case where there is zero confinement to the lattice points, you have the sort of relationship that you expect to exist between the energy of particles in the lattice and their momentum. And that is just a quadratic relation, like p squared over 2m, right? So all you see is a series of parabola. However, when you turn up the confinement, actually produce a lattice, what you see is an appearance of bands where the energy of the particles can only be in this green band or in this blue band or in this reddish pink band, but not in the white spaces in between, right? So this is sort of an important point of the behavior of crystals. They have these band gaps. They can't have these band gaps associated with different properties. Okay, and so a solid's band structure describes the allowable energy levels for electrons in a crystal lattice. And more specifically, the band structure explains material properties, for example, electrical resistivity and optical absorption. Okay. Now, it's a useful tool to describe the states of particles in these lattices using these block wave functions. And I want to show this here because when I get to talking about the data, the experiments that we've done, I'm really going to be talking about locations in momentum space associated with this lattice, where these wave functions start to behave sort of funny, where they become ill-defined. Okay, so these block wave functions, psi, they take this form. There's some spatial function multiplied by phase term, e to the I, q dot r, where q is the quasi-momentum. This is the in-lattice momentum. And this function u has this special property that it has these periodic boundary conditions where the function u of r evaluated at some location plus a lattice vector away. This lattice vector is the big R. The function has to be equal to itself. Okay. Now, it turns out that not only is the band structure important for describing the material properties, but so is the geometry and topology of the state space where the wave functions live. And this becomes important when you want to talk about physics related to, for example, quantum Hall effects or orbital magnetism or topological insulators, where now you're not only thinking about block wave functions, these psi's, but you want to start thinking about the Berry connection, right? This, what I'm calling AMN here, which is essentially the expectation value of the momentum operator in quasi-momentum space. Right? But nevertheless, what you want to be thinking about as well is the Berry connection. Okay. And so now I just sort of want to make a point about bosons versus fermions, because eventually what we do is we produce a Bose-Einstein condensate and we put it into a lattice. Okay. So the important point that I want to make here regarding the difference between bosons and fermions is how they behave when you trap them in a harmonic potential. Right. So what I'm plotting for you here is the energy levels for a quantum harmonic oscillator, where the quantized energy labels I'm labeling by these n's, n equals 0 through 3. So these horizontal lines are your energy levels. And what you find that's striking is that even at zero temperature, absolute zero temperature, bosons and fermions behave quite differently. What you see with bosons is that they're able to stack up in the lowest energy level. They're able to crowd on top of each other, whereas fermions are not able to do that due to Pauli exclusion. So fermions, instead of crowding all in the ground state of this harmonic oscillator, they stack themselves up to the Fermi energy, depending on how many particles you have, okay? But the fact that bosons do this, this crowding behavior in the lowest energy state, this allows us to make Bose-Einstein condensate. And so in my lab, we use the bosonic isotope, rubidium-87, to make BECs, Bose-Einstein condensates. And Bose-Einstein condensates are incredibly interesting still. So let me tell you a little bit about them. The de Broglie wavelength describes the wave-like behavior of matter generally. I'm writing an expression for the de Broglie wavelength here. And what I think is important to point out is that the de Broglie wavelength is inversely proportional to both mass and temperature, right? So the larger the mass, the greater the temperature, the shorter the de Broglie wavelength, and sort of the shorter distance over which this matter will exhibit wave-like properties that you associate with being quantum mechanical, okay? So if you have a low mass object and you get the temperature sufficiently low, then you can move your system into this interesting regime where the volume associated with the de Broglie wavelength becomes larger than the sort of volume per atom. So this is my system volume. This is the number of atoms. So when the de Broglie volume is bigger than the volume per atom, you sort of have this situation where the wave functions of your atoms start to overlap with each other, right? This pushes you into this quantum regime where now you have this new state of matter that has these interesting properties. Okay, so the Schrodinger equation is very useful for talking about the evolution of quantum systems. The Schrodinger equation has two parts, kinetic energy and potential energy. Here I'm writing down the time independent Schrodinger equation. Acting on this wave function psi, this gives you the energy. Okay, but to describe a Bose-Einstein condensate, you need to add one term that that includes interactions. And particularly, it's important to note that this term depends on the density. So this psi squared tells you the density. And so you see that the density of the atoms in the BEC, it changes the evolution of this system, right? So this is the sort of wave function associated with these block waves that I'll be talking about later in the talk. And I wanted to show an image from our lab. Here's a picture of a rubidium 87 BEC. That's around 10 to 100 nanokelvin temperature. Okay. And I totally skipped over talking about this picture, but when you move into this regime where the de Broglie volume is fulfills this equality, you push the velocity distribution of your atoms from one where you don't see strong peaking at zero to one where you, as you cool, you do see strong peaking at zero velocity or zero momentum. This is showing you the onset of Bose-Einstein condensation. Okay, so I've told you about one part of our quantum simulator. The atoms are Bose-Einstein condensates. Let me tell you about optical lattices. Mathematically, you can produce a standing wave by overlapping two counterpropagating waves, here the red and the blue, which together produce the black standing wave. Experimentally, I can do the same thing with two lasers. My lasers are traveling waves. And so if I look at some region where they overlap in the middle, I look at the time average electric field intensity, I get this nice standing wave pattern with the separation that's half of the wavelength. Now I have a one-dimensional lattice and I can load atoms into this lattice, okay? I can also use multiple pairs of intersecting beams to make either two-dimensional or three-dimensional lattices. And that's how I make an optical honeycomb lattice. I take three different lasers with electric field polarization that's in plane, and I have them overlap with each other with a relative angle of 120 degrees. If I look at the potential energy landscape in this intersection region that the atoms experience, what they see is a potential energy landscape that looks like this, where I've marked the local potential energy minima using these green circles. And what you see is a honeycomb lattice, right? So this honeycomb lattice, it has these two unit vectors, A23 and A12. And my unit cell looks like a box around these two points here, for example. And so I can take this box and I can copy it by moving it by one of these lattice vectors, and I can span my whole honeycomb lattice, right? And so this arrangement allows us to create an ultra-cold analog of what's like graphene. So let me tell you about why graphene is interesting. But before I do that, let me reiterate that a crystal's band structure and the geometry and topology of the state space determines its properties. Here I have an image of graphene. It's this single layer hexagonal arrangement of carbon atoms. And it's produced a lot of interesting signs. And even with the Nobel Prize being awarded for its initial discovery and characterization in 2010, this system and stacks of graphene is still producing a lot of interesting signs. Okay, the thing I wanted to point out about graphene that's relevant to my work and probes of band structure singularity is a special point that exists in the momentum space associated with the electrons in the graphene, right? That is the Dirac point. So let me point your attention to here. This is the band structure of graphene, where at this point labeled K in quasi-momentum, I have a touching point here between two bands. This point is referred to as a Dirac point, and it's special because confined to it is is Berry flux, and associated with the Berry phase that your, say, particle would accumulate. If you move the particle around this point in this momentum space. And it's special because it's not a dynamical phase. It doesn't depend on how quickly you move your particle around it. So long as you complete a loop around this point, regardless of the radius of that loop, you will pick up a pi Berry phase from the Dirac point. It turns out that that pi Berry phase is associated with some very interesting physics that appears in graphene. For example, Klein tunneling, where you get this sort of resonant tunneling, quantum tunneling of electrons across huge potential barriers that you wouldn't expect them to be able to tunnel through. Or even the half-integer quantum Hall effect, where people have seen in graphene quantized conductance, which is the size of which is set by Planck's constant over the electron charge squared. But instead of these jumps being proportional to integer multiples of that ratio of fundamental constants, it's proportional to half-integer multiples. Right? Or even newer, interesting systems built from graphene, twisted bilayer graphene that I'm depicting here, where you can stack two graphene sheets on top of each other, you know, turn them by some angle, and what you see is this moiré pattern, the emergence of this different structure, a longer scale structure. And people have seen a lot of interesting physics here, even the emergence of superconductivity that happens at this interface, depending on the angle that you have these sheets relative to each other. Okay, so graphene is an incredibly interesting material still. We're still learning a lot from it. And I want to make the point that my artificial graphene also has Dirac points with interesting topological properties. Okay, so I've told you just about everything I want to, and to tell you about how we build our, at least the conceptual parts of how we build our quantum simulator. We produce Bose-Einstein condensates using rubidium. We produce optical lattices of various geometries. Here I'm talking about the hexagon lattice. And we load our Bose-Einstein condensate into this lattice and do experiments to study various physics. Okay, so to do this in practice, we sort of have two parts. You know, all these cold atom systems have sort of two parts. One is what I would call a light preparation table. The other part is a science table. So let me start with the light preparation table. I'm not going to say a ton about this because, you know, as you can see, this is a pretty densely populated optical table, but this table has some laser. This is sort of the main laser that goes to some spectroscopy setup where I can lock my laser to the energy difference between two states in the rubidium that I can use to produce light that allows me to cool and trap the rubidium atoms. I can take another laser here. This is what, you know, jargony term, we call it a repump laser, where I use this light to, you know, put atoms that move out of the two levels, the two energy levels that I like to use to cool them. I put them back into that manifold so I can send resonant light, cycle them between these two energy levels and produce the cooling and trapping forces that I need. Okay, this is essentially what this whole table is for, producing cooling and trapping light for rubidium. This other part is the science table. This is where the actual experiments happen, right in this region here. So after quite a few steps, where I start with a hot gas of rubidium around 120 Celsius that comes out of an oven. I send it down a long tube where I can apply soaring forces. I capture it in what's called a magneto-optical trap and do some initial cooling down to tens or so microkelvin. I eventually move them over to this region here, the sort of in the center of this region here, where I do the last steps of evaporation processes, and I produce a Bose-Einstein condensate. There's my mouse, there we go, right in this region here. Now I can also send my lattice beams in, which I do from this direction, and from this direction, right over top my BEC, and that's how I load my atoms into the lattice. Now to do the imaging that I'm gonna show you later on, we do absorption imaging. So we have this vertical optical table here. We send light down from the top right onto the BEC. and in the lattice. And essentially we cast a shadow down onto a camera down here, right? So we're taking images of the shadows created by these atoms. Okay. So let me actually get into the measurements that I want to talk about. What I'm showing you here is a two-dimensional Brillouin zone map. So this is a useful map that you use to see how the energy is related to the in-lattice momentum of your particles, right? It has these four regions that I'm showing you, which I've color-coded differently. This inner green hexagon, the blue star, the pink hexagon, and this purple hexagon. Now, again, this is a map of the different Brillouin zones. This is the first Brillouin zone, the blue is the second, red is the third, purple is the fourth. And it's you can connect it to the actual band structure of our atoms in the lattice. And so I'm making the connection that this first Brillouin zone is somehow associated with this lowest energy band in this band structure that I've calculated for you. The second Brillouin zone has some connection to this second energy band, and so on. And so in this talk, in the rest of the talk, I'm going to tell you about two interesting points. This point labeled K, where I have a Dirac point, that is a linear band touching point. That's what LBTP is. And very specially, I'm going to tell you about this quadratic band touching point that occurs at this point labeled gamma. Okay. So before I move on and tell you about how I've been characterizing these band structure singularities, that is these quadratic and linear band touching points, let me tell you about some work that other cold atom systems have done on linear band touching points. There's, for example, this work that's come out from the Schneider Block group and Esslinger group, where they measure that quantized Berry phase that I mentioned to you that's associated with the Dirac point, where they use interference techniques to have their atoms take a loop around these Dirac points, say K or K prime, and they're able to see that after undergoing a loop around the Dirac point, their system, it acquires a phase jump of pi, right? So this is that special behavior associated with the Dirac point. This is that quantized Berry flux that's associated with the Dirac point. Another system where they're actually able to tune their system between looking like just graphene that has two equally deep sites in the unit cell to something like hexagonal boron nitride, where the two sites of the unit cell are unequal. They also see a phase evolution, a geometric phase evolution of pi associated with the Dirac point when they tune their system to look like graphene. And when they make their system not look like graphene, which means when they investigate this point K and there's no longer a linear band touching point, which means there's no longer a Dirac point, they no longer see this phase accumulation of pi. There are even other experiments where they can do full state tomography, right? They can reconstruct the quantum states in amplitude and phase across the Brillouin zone, and even do things like measure the Berry curvature confined at these K points, right? So this is showing confined Berry curvature, Berry flux at these Dirac points. Or in this experiment, measuring how when you evolve your system through these points, you again pick up these pi Berry phases. Okay, so basically what has happened for the most part to date is that cold atom experiments have used interferometric techniques that involve going around singularities and band structures, like physically looping around them, to study some properties of the band structure. But what I have been doing is something very different. Instead of taking loops around them, I evolve my system through the singularity, right? Okay, so how do I do that? Well, I can translate my lattice in a way that is equivalent to having a stationary lattice, but evolving the quasi-momentum of my atoms in that lattice. So it's an issue of reference frames. Even if I move my lattice in the frame of the lattice, it's as though the atoms are moving, right? So that's how I translate the in lattice momentum of my atoms. And I can do this with a nice closed loop feedback system. So I can give my lattice a velocity that looks like this expression here. This F1, 2, and this F2, 3, these are experimentally controlled parameters. These are knobs that I can turn. I can make them time dependent. And these vectors, A1, 2, and A2, 3, these are the lattice vectors that I use to span my honeycomb lattice. And so since I can make these coefficients, F1, 2, and F2, 3, essentially arbitrarily time dependent, I can move my lattice in some arbitrary trajectory, some arbitrary velocity in two dimensions. Now, the quasi-momentum of my atoms in the frame of the lattice is related to the lattice velocity in this way. It's just a proportionality constant minus the single particle mass. Okay, so what this means is that I can give my atoms in the lattice frame an arbitrary momentum q in two dimensions. Here is an example of me doing that in the sort of result. Now I can plug the block wave function into the Hamiltonian that describes the system, and I can predict what diffraction should look like. Where I load my atoms into the lattice, I shut my lattice off. I can take images of that tell me about the resulting momentum space structure of the state. That's what these images are. And when I use this theory to predict what this diffraction image should look like when I don't give the atoms any velocity, any momentum, then I see a diffraction pattern that looks like this with this nice six-fold rotation symmetry. And when I do the experiment and I take an actual image of the lattice, I recover what I expect. Now I can do something different where I can give my atoms some quasi-momentum that is, it happens to be this in this case. I picked it because it shows that we do have good control over our quasi-momentum. It's 1.33 times the distance from gamma to k. That's what this qk is, right? So I can give my atoms momentum that goes right over to this point here. I can see what I expect this diffraction image to look like from theory, and I can go and measure it, and I see nice agreement between this theory and this experiment. So I just wanted to make the point that we have good control over our atoms quasi-momentum. Okay, and this is important because what I'm going to do is send atoms along trajectories in this momentum space.
Hey, Charles.
Yeah.
Is the mass in that momentum equation a rubidium mass? Just one, not that number that are in the well.
Yeah, so everything that I'm talking to you about right now is single particle physics.
Great, thanks.
Okay, so let me get into the first measurement. Here I am, again, I'm not sending my atoms along trajectories that wrap around one of these singularities here, a Dirac point. I'm sending the atoms directly through the Dirac point. How do I do that? Well, let's look at this zoom in here in A. My atoms start at gamma, which is in the center of my Brillouin zone map, in the center of this green hexagon. And I evolve them over to the Dirac point labeled K, and I turn at some angle theta. Okay. Now, when I turn at that angle theta, I take a special kind of image that allows me to measure the proportion of atoms that are in different energy levels, say the lowest energy band of the lattice or the second lowest, et cetera. And I do this sort of experiment for various theta that lie, I do this experiment for various theta where the final point in this Brillouin zone map where I take images of my atoms, they lie on this circle. The circle has a radius of 0.4 times the distance in momentum space between gamma and the Dirac point. Okay, so I do this sort of experiment. I take these images that allow me to understand what is the proportion of different atoms in different bands. And I overlay the Brillouin zone on top of it. That's what's happening in C here. And I'm showing you what this looks like for various angles, theta equals 0, pi over 2, pi, 3 pi over 2. So let's talk about this first image. I mentioned to you that this inner hexagon is associated with the first Brillouin zone. I can associate this with the first band. And so when I compare how many atoms I see here, which is this is most of the atoms in this image, to say how many are in the second Brillouin zone, these triangles here, here and here. This is the second Brillouin zone, sorry. This is the third Brillouin zone. I know that most of my atoms for a trajectory that goes to the Dirac point and then comes back, they remain in the lowest energy band. However, if I say evolve my atoms from gamma to the Dirac point and then I turn by 90 degrees, so that is going along this trajectory and then turning at 90 degrees, I see something very different. I see that the proportion of atoms that remain in the first band, right, which is the atoms here, is much more similar to the proportion that lands in that ends up in the second band, right? And so again, I can do this sort of measurement for various theta. I can track how the proportion of atoms change, and I can plot this. And this is exactly what I'm doing here in D, right? So again, in the green, I'm plotting as a function of that turn angle, the proportion of atoms that remain in the ground band, the lowest energy band of lattice. That's the green data. Versus the proportion of atoms that move into the second band. This is the second lowest energy band. That's the blue data. And what I see for these trajectories that make one loop on this circle, I see the atoms initially remaining entirely in the first band, essentially all of the atoms leaving the first band going to the second band, and then the sort of opposite happening again. Right, so I make sort of one rotation between these bands as I go from 0 to 2 pi around this circle. Okay, so why is this? A nice way to think about this is using a two-band model, where I can think of my system as a pseudo spin 1/2 in a pseudo-magnetic field. Right? So away from the Dirac point, my pseudo-magnetic field appears to grow linearly. And in this gauge that I've shown, it points outwards, okay? Now I can imagine that what I've really done in this sort of experiment is, say, move along this ray from gamma over to the Dirac point and turn at some angle. When I come along this trajectory over into the Dirac point, I can think of that as spin down. When I move through the Dirac point, the effective or the pseudo-magnetic field goes to zero. And as soon as I move away from that zero, as soon as I move away from the Dirac point, I now have a spin down in my initial basis that is in a magnetic field that has changed direction. And so all of a sudden, I'm in a sort of superposition of spin up and spin down in the new basis dependent on the magnetic field that my system sees when I move away from the Dirac point. Okay, and so it's important to note that these population dynamics, seeing the atoms sort of switch between ground band and excited band, this is not a dynamical effect. It's driven by the Berry connection. In particular, it's driven by the off-diagonal elements of the Berry connection, right? So in the typical cold atom experiments that I showed you, what they are investigating is the diagonal elements of this Berry connection that I can write as a matrix. That's what has directly encoded into it the Berry phase. However, what drives these population dynamics is the off-diagonal elements associated with non-abelian state rotation. Okay? Now, it's important to think about how this is not an interferometric measurement. Okay? In fact, this is a measurement of quantum distance. Right? So I've defined quantum distance here in this way. What I'm calling quantum distance is this quantity d squared. It's equal to 1 minus the inner product of the cell periodic parts of the block wave function. So I wrote down the block wave function, and I said that, hey, it's equal to this u multiplied by some e to the I q dot r. The u that appears in the block wave function, that's what this is, right? This is important because this directly reveals this quantity called the quantum metric tensor G. And so I could write down a metric tensor, this GIJ, in quasi-momentum space that looks very similar to, say, what a relativist would write down when specifying distance in space-time. So I'm just making this point because this allows us to think about the distances in this Hilbert space where the wave functions live, and how it's actually important for describing the properties of real materials. Let me give a concrete example of this. It's been recently shown that in these systems that have flat energy bands that make touching points with other bands where the wave function is ill-defined at that point, you can have Landau levels where these Landau levels, which were previously very degenerate, become split. And the splitting is spaced by this quantum distance parameter. Right? So this is actually relevant for the behavior of physical systems. I'll make a quick point about this before I move on to the really, really cool thing. And that's the effective size of these Dirac singularities. So I can evolve my system, say from gamma over to another gamma point. And I can either move my atoms through the Dirac point, or I can move them through this Brillouin zone, through this momentum space at various distances from the Dirac point. Okay, what do I see when I measure the proportion of atoms in different bands? Well, it depending on if I go through the Dirac point or not, it depends on how fast I do so. So for trajectories that go from gamma to this Dirac point to gamma, say here or here, I essentially see no variation in the distribution of atoms between the ground and excited bands. However, if I say go from gamma to M to gamma where there's a gap, then I see that as I go along this evolution increasingly slowly, say from the increasingly slowly, so the blue to the pink, I see that more of my atoms remain in their initial band, that is in the ground band as I do this evolution. And this is what you would expect from like Landau zener physics, okay? Now I can set a threshold, say 0.5, this dotted line, and I can see for trajectories that don't touch the Dirac point, how when the population of atoms reach this threshold as a function of time, which is what I'm plotting here. And so what this suggests is that these Dirac points have an effective size that depends on how fast I'm evolving my system through this space. Why is that? Well, at some point I can evolve my system quickly with respect to a local band gap, right? And at that point, the bands look effectively degenerate, right? So it's as though the singularity where the bands are degenerate has grown in size, okay. This is the last sort of bit of science. I know I'm at 50 minutes, so I will wrap this up quickly. Not this part, the next part, the conclusion, wrap it quickly. This is a really special measurement. Why is it special? Well, this is special because before now, this sort of experiment couldn't be done using an ultra-cold atom system. Why is that? Okay, well, I'm now investigating a different kind of touching point. This is not a band touching point where the dispersion is linear, that has associated with it a pi Berry phase. This quadratic band touching point has associated with it a 2 pi Berry phase, which in an interferometric measurement, you could not distinguish from zero. Right? So as it turns out, in the typical way of doing these measurements with cold atoms, you wouldn't be able to distinguish a topologically non-trivial band touching point from a topologically trivial one. However, by doing quantum distance measurements like what I've done recently, you're able to see, is this quadratic band touching point topologically interesting? Is there some sort of winding number that that characterizes this touching point like there is clearly for the Dirac point? Okay, so how do we do this? Well, we're able to load our atoms directly into the third energy band, okay? And I'm happy to talk about how we do that perhaps later if people want to ask about that. But we can load our atoms directly into the third energy band. What I showed in this band structure that I calculated is that the third energy band and the fourth energy band, they have a quadratic band touching point. So I can load the atoms into this third band, say in some region here, and I can evolve them over to the quadratic band touching point. That's what I'm showing in this Brillouin zone map. Load them into the third band, I move over to the quadratic band touching point. And again, I'm going to turn by some angle theta. That's going to make some full loop around the quadratic band touching point. Again, I can think about this as a pseudo spin in a pseudo magnetic field with one very important difference. as I make a loop around that goes through the quadratic band touching point, the effective magnetic field or the pseudomagnetic field that my that describes my system, it wraps twice for one revolution around this point. That's the special difference here. And I can see that in my measurement. If I go and measure the proportion of atoms, say in the third band or fourth or the fourth band, as a function of the angle that I exit the quadratic band touching point, instead of one oscillation switching between the two bands, I see that there are two oscillations. That's what I'm tracing with my mouse. And so I see that atoms initially in the third band, they move into the fourth band, back into the third band, into the fourth band, back into the third band, over the same region, 0 to 2 pi, for which I measured only one such rotation by going through the Dirac point. Okay, and so what we've measured here in both cases, for the Dirac point and the quadratic band touching point, is a winding number. It's a winding number of one. That's one rotation around the Dirac point, or winding number of two here for the quadratic band touching point. Okay. And so I've gotten to my conclusion. I know I'm at 53 minutes. Sorry for going a little bit into the questions. But I want to conclude with this point, that an ultracold atom quantum simulator is a very powerful tool that allows for simulation of real materials or toy Hamiltonians that are still very interesting. Crucially, measurements of quantum distance allow the non-trivial topology of both Dirac points and quadratic band touching points to be directly revealed. And in these measurements, we've observed quantized winding numbers of one associated with the Dirac point, and two, using this new technique that, you know, which could not have been done before, we see a winding number of two around the quadratic band touching point. Okay, so there's lots of future work to be done here. You know, in many ways, we're a Kagome lattice team that cares about flat bands. It turns out that I have a lot of laser power. And so that third energy band that I showed you, where we have a quadratic band touching point, I can make that band very flat by cranking up my laser. And so this gives us access to this question that we care about a lot, and that is, where do bosons condense in a flat band? And this is something that we're interested in looking at. The sort of immediate next project that we're considering is, what happens if you hold atoms at these singularities for various times? An example of which is I'm showing right here. So in this experiment, what we've done is we've evolved the atoms to the quadratic band touching point between the third and fourth bands, and we've held them there for a while. I can't say a whole lot about what's happening here, but certainly interesting. You can see that the atoms are aligning with the edges of the third Brillouin zone. Okay. And so I just want to just sort of with this suggest that, you know, this was the start of some interesting topological investigation of these singularities, but, you know, we can also use this evolution through momentum space to study things like squeezing as it appears in these cold atom systems associated with the band structure, which I believe is related to what we're seeing here in this image of atoms that I took in the lab. Okay, and let me make one more quick point, very, very quick. I think this is very interesting. Two-time Nobel laureate Linus Pauling, on one particularly cranky morning, once said, there's no such thing as quasi-crystals, only quasi-scientists. Despite that fact, the people had discovered, specifically Dan Checkman, had discovered a five-fold rotation symmetric quasi-crystal. Right? This is a rotation symmetry that's not allowed for periodic lattices. And this result from this PRL from back in the 80s shows exactly this from this Luna-Meganese alloy. So what are quasi-crystals? They are periodic, but they are aperiodic but ordered. They have no translation symmetry. One thing that's interesting is that superconductivity back in 2018 was shown, and it looks like that in the solid state five-fold rotation symmetric quasicrystals, there's a maybe interesting form of superconductivity that would be interesting to study. But I find it particularly interesting to think about what happens to, say, fermions in the system, in terms of the phase diagram that you might be able to explore. You don't have a well-defined, you don't have translation symmetry, so you don't have a well-defined Fermi surface. And so I think that such a five-fold rotation symmetric ultra-cold atom quasi-crystal would be generally interesting to study you know, quantum physics of quasicrystals, how wave packets diffuse in these quasicrystals, this particularly unique type of excitation called phasons that exist, and generally topology in quasicrystals. Okay, thanks for entertaining me going to the questions. I am all done. Thank you very much.
Okay, so let's thank Charles. And we definitely have time for questions. So why don't we just have people unmute, and as long as we can keep it orderly, ask their questions that way.
Okay, even though he planted this question, I'd like to know how he loads directly into the third zone.
Yeah, so I can do so by translating a lattice that almost doesn't look like a lattice. So there's this idea of recoil energy, and this is important. And it's not really until the depth of my lattice exceeds the recoil energy that the atoms really sense a lattice. So what I can do is have a very shallow lattice, like a very shallow potential energy minimum. I can translate it to some quasi-momentum that is associated with the third Brillouin zone, such that when I finally ramp up my lattice and I open up gaps, my atoms are adiabatically loaded into the third band. So let me try to do some stuff with my hands. Maybe that would be helpful. For free particles, I have just a quadratic dispersion, right? So imagine just one-dimensional system with no lattice. The energy versus momentum of my particles just looks like a parabola, right? And so I can mark where the first Brillouin zone would be, where the second Brillouin zone would be, where the third Brillouin zone would be, right? Imagine that I move the momentum of my particles over to the third Brillouin zone, and then I ramp up this system and open up gaps at the Brillouin zone edges. Then the only state that I can connect to is the state in the third band that's associated to the fact that I move my atom's momentum all the way over to where the third Brillouin zone is.
Great, thanks.
Other questions?
Jack, can I ask a question?
Yeah, of course, anybody can ask a question.
Hey, Charles. So, nice talk. So you were mentioning quantum simulation, but you didn't comment on interactions. So everything was single particle physics. Can you actually say first why interactions are negligible in the physics that you studied, and what would be interesting if you're taking interactions into account?
Yeah. So we do not have good control over the interactions in our system. You know, it'd be nice if we had this nice, these nice Feshbach interactions, right, that are tunable with magnetic field, where we can actually explore this. We definitely go through, at least for these experiments, we went through attempts to minimize interaction effects because we didn't want to see that in this experiment. And we did so by trying to use as shallow of lattices as possible, such that in the individual wells of the lattice, you can sort of decrease what the density of bosons want to be. And by just starting off in the beginning of the measurement with a BEC that has a smaller atom number. Right? That's about all we can do to decrease the interactions. Now, how do I know that interactions don't play a big role? Well, it's because I don't see any strong effect of gapping, for example, at the direct point. Right, so I would expect that if I had some significant interactions, then I would open up a significant gap. And I can evolve my atoms through the direct point more slowly and more slowly. I can evolve my atoms through the direct point, at which case I would expect to see atoms go from the ground band to the excited band because of this, this off-diagonal element of the Berry connection I mentioned. But I go more slowly and more slowly and more slowly, and I never get to a situation where I don't see that where I don't see the state rotation, the flipping from ground to excited band. if I had sufficiently strong interactions, I would open up a gap. And if there's a minimum gap, then there's a sufficiently slow speed at which I would be able to evolve my atoms and not see any atoms go to the second band. And we've looked for it and we just can't see it. Truth be told, I think that there's probably some tiny gap that comes from a vector Stark shift, right? So there's a polarization change that happens across the A and B sides of my unit cell. And for that reason, I know that technically there has to be a small gap. It's just really, really small, so small that we can't see it, and it's not important on any relevant time scales of this experiment.
Actually,
sorry, can I actually add one more thing? So you asked me about why it would be interesting to study interactions. So I think that's particularly interesting for the quadratic band touching point. So there's a bunch of cool work that suggests that maybe interactions would cause a quadratic band touching point to break into multiple direct points, for example. So if you have some tunable interactions, then maybe you can see these interesting topological transitions where a quadratic band touching point, say, splits into two direct points. I would like to look at that. Leonid, you're saying?
Yeah. It turns into discussion, so I'm not sure. I'll just take, maybe 90 seconds.
That's fine. We started a few minutes late, so I think it's okay to stick around a few minutes past five.
Yeah. So yeah, this question about interactions is actually very interesting. But I would think, that let's start with both condensate without all these additional problems, right? So then basically you have a certain spread in momentum space. And the stronger the interaction is, the bigger the spread of the in the momentum space. You have shown this figure since the beginning of this yellow thing on the blue background, right? And the stronger the interaction, the wider the momentum spread of your Bose condensate state, I would say, right? So I think that you don't want strong interactions between bosons because you want a nice momentum resolution.
Yep.
Now, as to the opening of the gap because of interactions is less clear because this gap is just a single particle effect, right? It's an effect of an atom in the field of lasers. So it's not obvious to me that actually you'll open a gap by interactions.
Yeah, I'm totally not suggesting that it's obvious, but we can sort of look at what looks like, I realize it's sort of strange to talk about band structure when you're talking about interacting systems. But we can write out what the band structure looks like when you consider say, the density of the BEC. And we do see what looks like, depending on how dense the BEC is, gaps open. So that's where that comes from. I don't think that it's obvious.
But what is the width? I mean, regardless BEC or no BEC, so what is the width of the momentum spread in the state you prepared that you then pass through the direct point?
Yeah,
compared to the brilliant zone size.
Yeah, so it's about this is not suggested by the images that I showed, but in units of h bar k, the spread is something like 1 or 2%.
I see.
Of h bar k.
Narrow, yeah.
Yeah, and they look bigger because artifacts of the imaging that we do. So that's why I look big on the brilliant zone maps that I showed, but. In actuality, it's 1 or 2% of H bar K.
And after you scatter, the size is the same. It's still 1% of brilliant zone, or?
Yeah, we actually don't really see that change.
I see. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, so we're up on time, but I did see one hand from Yoram. Yoram, is your question sort of on the briefer side?
Yeah, I can be very brief. So.
Okay, and then we'll.
In quantum simulation, usually the. Hoping the experiment you can measure something that the theorist cannot calculate if the system is very big in the interaction. So in your physics, which is mostly single electron physics, is there something challenging you can do that we theorists cannot calculate?
With the system that I described today?
Yes, or maybe with future systems.
Well, I would suspect generically that if I used fermions instead, mm-hmm. then the degree to which properties can of the system can be predicted, it becomes much more difficult to do so.
Right.
So I would think that the best case for the use of a quantum simulator. Although I think it's important to do lots of stuff with bosons and lattices like this. If we're going to talk about quantum simulation, then I think you should look at fermions. And I think that there's lots of stuff with fermions and lattices where experimentalists can sort of help guide the sort of things that the community, including theorists, are thinking about.
Right. Anyway, I think it's a very nice talk. Thank you very much for that.
So I think that's a good place to close the physics club here. Thank you, Charles, for your talk. Just thank Charles one more time. And thanks everyone for attending. I'll be closing out the meeting, but look forward to seeing you all in the near future.
Thanks, Charles.
Thank you.
See you tomorrow.
Charles, very nice talk.